Loujain's release today is conditional, right? Her court is still going on. She can still be brought back to jail. We don't know under what conditions did they make her sign to leave, right? And so the thing is, with all of these small wins, all these small victories, as much as I am unbelievably happy for her and her family, this does not mean that this is a permanent change, right? They can take this away at any minute. And so this is the problem with human rights in Saudi Arabia right now, and the lack of structural reform in the country, where you are asking for the smallest of things, and you can still be arrested for saying nothing. Because, I mean, for example, we have cases of political prisoners who didn't say a thing. Right. Like, so there's a week ago now, some people have been released that were arrested in April of 2019. And it's not even clear what they've done. They hadn't been tweeting or been active for years. And so it's come to such a dark time right now in Saudi Arabia, where you could be arrested for not saying enough, or you're arrested for saying too much or not saying anything at all. And so the haphazardness of the mood of the political climate in Saudi Arabia right now is really quite dark. And so I am very skeptical about how serious the government is, even with the move of releasing Loujain now, or temporarily releasing, conditionally releasing Loujain now, mm-hmm. is that this is in response to foreign countries, more specifically to the Americans, mm-hmm. to the new Biden administration, right? And so they want to lessen that pressure on them by saying, oh, look, all these people that we're releasing, subhanAllah, all of a sudden you're able to finish everybody's court cases and deal with their cases and release them. You couldn't have done that for years. You had to destroy all these people's lives and their families, dealing with the torture of all of this. I mean, I can't help but being angry that all of this was unnecessary.
Yeah. And do you think her release has a lot to do with international pressure?
Can we, everybody, when they're talking about Loujain, please remember to say conditional release,
right? Yes.
Because that is a win for the government. This is a PR move for the government when they do this. If we don't say conditional release, right, then people forget that she is actually still facing a trial, that she is still in the process of getting her freedom, right? She, even if this case finishes, she's still under a travel ban, right? And so her freedom has not been fully restored. So if you could please just remember to say conditional release.
Absolutely, yes.
Sorry, continue.
So basically now is the time to talk more about the specific case with Lina, which is mm-hmm. due to obvious reasons not what we're doing now. So I thought I'm gonna leave the floor to Alicia, who will ask more about the general women's rights situation.
Yeah, so to get a bit of like an understanding of what context Loujain has acted in, and the current state of women's rights in Saudi Arabia today. As you said, like, there has been a lot of PR moves that make the country seem like it's on the path of change. But mm-hmm. is that actually the case? And if not, what obstacles do you see today of both women's rights and human rights in general?
Right. I think what's happening right now, there are two parallel universes, right? There is the universe where Saudi Arabia is actually reforming, changing, giving Saudi women a lot of rights. And then there's the parallel one, right? For anyone who's saying anything, to dare to say anything that doesn't go with the narrative and the rhetoric of the Saudi government, they are arrested, right? And so, yes, women have been given the right to drive, but the woman who dared to collectively ask for the right to drive, in jail. Right, women now can work, can do a lot of things they couldn't do before. Right, but now there is a two-tier system in Saudi Arabia, for example, in tourism and in the job market, where if you're a foreign woman, right, you're allowed to stay with your boyfriend in a hotel in Saudi Arabia when you're going there on tourism. Those rights are not given to Saudi women. They are still a lot more constrained than any foreign woman that lives in Saudi Arabia. And so Saudi Arabia right now is constantly creating these parallel universes, right, of the haves and have-nots. For example, even with the woman driving, right? There is a huge class issue in Saudi Arabia, and we must acknowledge that when we're talking about women's rights specifically about human rights in general, of who has access to what, right? And so, for example, the woman driving. Yes, now technically all women can drive in Saudi Arabia, but let's talk about how many driving schools there are in Saudi Arabia right now. How much does it cost to learn how to drive in Saudi Arabia right now? What is the length of the waiting list to be able to get that, right? And so you're talking about, we did a survey about how the lifting and the ban of driving has impacted lives of Saudi women, right? A lot of the women that have said that they don't have a driver's license so far, one of the main reasons is she can't afford it. The school is too far from where she lives, so she would have to commute for 2 hours to go to one. She can't get an appointment to get to one. There is no school that is close to her. And so that, like, truly the devil is in the details of how women are given those rights, right? Even when they change the laws, right? They don't do it in a way that is meaningful, that reaches out to all segments of society. And so this is where I'm talking about the parallel lives here of some people. Yes, this must have drastically changed how they live in Saudi Arabia. And those who are already of a poorer class are suffering still and are still having the problems of they still need the permission of the father or whoever her guardian is to get the access to these things, even though technically that is no longer the case, right? And so it's a very complicated, I know I asked you if you're going to ask about the announcements on Monday about the change of laws. Part of the problem of what's going on in Saudi Arabia right now, that even the good laws that are on the books right now are not necessarily acted upon, right? And so it is very selective in the acting. I mean, and this is, if we're talking about, for example, reporting rape, it is an issue across the board in all the world, right? We're talking about the number of people who will dare to go to a police station to report a rape. In Saudi Arabia, it's the same thing, right? But it's even worse because of all the compounded elements, what it means to actually do that socially and all of that. And so all of these things come to a really difficult situation where the Saudi government can say to the world, look, we've changed the laws. Look, all these things that are giving women more access, right? But in actuality, if a police station is still refusing to have to give that respect to the women themselves, right? And so about a week ago, I think, there was a murder case. Yeah, this woman was killed by her two brothers, and her body was disappeared, and then they finally found the body after the mother and the sister made a big deal about looking for their for her, and then they shut down her sister's account because she was asking for justice for her sister, and then the mother started asking for justice for her daughter, and it was just a mess. And it just was such a symbolic case of, to this day, even when Saudi Arabia insists on telling the world that they've given rights and they've liberalized and now this is the new Saudi Arabia and no more of this Wahhabi shit that we had before, we were over that, but in reality, fundamentally, the people that work in these institutions are the same misogynist men, right? We are still a patriarchy, and this patriarchy still will not give rights and respect to the woman inside the country, right? And I'm not talking a woman can be misogynist as well, don't get me wrong, but we're talking about the system. The system itself will not give away this power to these women, right? And like one of the things, like Loujain did a lot of really amazing things before she was arrested, right? And so, but I think fundamentally, they didn't want any woman to feel that she's empowered to change her world, right? And that is the scariest thing about what's going on in Saudi Arabia right now. When these women had the audacity to demand the reforms for themselves, right? And so that is the fundamental thing of understanding why they ended up in jail, I think. It was a message to all the other women, don't get this wrong. We only give you the rights we deign to give you, not because you asked for them.
That's very interesting to hear, like, your inside perspective, kind of, to see how it's, yeah, the problem with implementation. But as you said, like, there is a lot of activists who are active and trying to change this. Do you know anything of how that has changed since Loujain's case and others were very internationally acknowledged a few years ago? And if that has kind of empowered women to stand up for their rights, or yeah, how, what is your perspective on the current state of activism in Saudi Arabia today?
I think it's a very dark situation right now because of these arrests, they gave a signal, clear signal, to anybody else that would dare to even think about this, right? That this is not it's not something that will be tolerated by the state. And so, for example, before, during King Abdullah's time, people were being arrested for their activism, right? But it was very unusual if their family members were arrested as well, if their family members were put under a travel ban. And so there wasn't that element of a collective punishment, right? Now that is a clear policy of the government to punish everybody around them. For example, Loujain's family, all of them are under a travel ban, right? Not just her, not just her being in prison. Everybody else is. Only reason Loujain and Alia and Walid weren't under that travel ban is that they were outside when the travel ban was put, right? And so this is the other aspect of why this has become scarier. Saudi Arabia is a very, very close-knit society. Families are very close. And so now, not only do you have to worry about, do I want to be going to prison if I do this? Do I want to be responsible for getting my family to be arrested as well, right? And so there's the layers of responsibility that they've put on the individual who wants their rights have now become profound. It is so unjust. And so unfortunately for me, I think it's gone darker since King Salman has taken power.
Yeah, that is not very hopeful, but it's good to get like a current like update on it. And
I'm not the hopeful type. I'm sorry.
No, it's hard to be that sometimes. But we are starting to get some questions, and I think we can start with the first one that continues the kind of question of issues of like implementation and having two faces kind of. So Hani, would you like to ask your question yourself, or should I read it?
I'll ask it myself. Alhamdulillah, as-salamu al-sama, Safa.
Allah yasalamu.
Jay, as-salik al-as-sila, badik iya bil-arabi?
I think nobody else speaks Arabic.
That's fine.
You should do it in English.
Yeah, it's fine. So like, I'm also an activist. I was almost arrested in Lebanon. I'm from Lebanon, and I was almost arrested in Lebanon for criticizing Saudi Arabia against the women's rights. Mm. And I want to ask you a question. That Saudi Arabia, this hypocritical phrase of the United Nations, has appointed Saudi Arabia as the chair of the Human Rights Council. What is your intake about this?
Was they weren't voted this time? They failed.
The last time, but the
last time.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, thank God they're not anymore.
Yeah.
but I think this is part of. How do I politely say something critical about the UN? That is part of the structure of the UN, right? Mm. Of who are allowed in. I mean, Russia was allowed. China. I mean, who would think that China or Russia have good human rights records, right? And so it's more of the bureaucracy of the UN that should be criticized for this, frankly, and not for the Saudis, because the Saudis have been there for several times now, and they use it for their own whitewashing. For the UN, it's just one of the bureaucracies. But that is part of what I think the UN needs to rethink how they let people into the council, but also the responsibilities of the member of the council, what standards they're requiring. But to me, this is more a critique of the UN structure, frankly, than the Saudis. The Saudis got what they wanted. Yes. You can't blame them for putting themselves up. It's a UN hypocrisy, as far as I'm concerned.
100%. Shukran, Pierre.
Thank you for your question, Hani. We actually have a question about the clarification on her case. So if Pauline, would you like to ask your question?
Actually, there is, hello, my name is Pauline, I'm a journalist for the Belgian newspaper Le Soir. I have like a double question. First is, why in your view, but I don't know if you can express it, why did the Saudi justice decide to give conditional freedom to Loujain AlHathloul? And my second question would be, isn't in other countries, the Saudi justice independent from the king from the king.
Okay. So why, that was already a decision that was made last December, right? So her lease, it was expected. The only difference was that we were confused about when exactly, because we didn't know how they counted, because we have the Hijri calendar. So we have the Muslim calendar, which is the lunar calendar, not a Gregorian. So boring logistics of difference of 11 days between the two calendars and stuff like that. And so it wasn't really clear when they would actually do it, but they had already announced that in December, right? And so that was, this is in reference to the why is the Biden administration. I believe that a lot of the cases that were pending for a very long time, because they were delaying their cases for an extremely long time, one after the other. Like, for example, most of 2020 with COVID, most of the court cases were delayed, right? But just like that, in December, although we still have COVID, they managed to clear all these cases, right? And sorry, what was the second question? Oh, the independent judiciary.
Yeah, my second question was about the independence of justice.
Yeah. Saudi Arabia doesn't have an independent anything. Okay, it is a monarchy. It's an absolute monarchy. There is not independent institutions that are not related to anything. It's a farce. And even though they want to claim that the judicial system in Saudi Arabia is independent of the king, that is not true. Right. And so, for example, part of the system of if you get death penalty for someone, right, and they lose the appeal, the king still has the right to forgive that person for, on death penalty. Right. And so the king is the ultimate arbiter of everything in the country. And so you have to understand that within that context. So there's no such, it's part of the structure of what a monarchy is. An absolute monarchy is that the king is the end all be all of everything in Saudi Arabia. And so all the so-called legal reforms that are happening right now, as I was, we were talking with Lina before she heard the news, right? And we're talking about how this actually lessens the power of the judges themselves, right? And so the way the judicial system is set up right now is that the judge has a lot of power in his own court, right? Which results in a lot of inconsistencies between the different cases. And so depending on what who's the judge that you get, you might get varying degrees of a punishment, right? And so there's nothing consistent about it. And so what they're trying to do now is codify it so then there is less of that. But in reality, as we saw, for example, in the writs, when they accused the most powerful people in Saudi Arabia of corruption, right? There was absolutely no transparency in, okay, what are the evidence against these people that you're accusing of corruption with billions of dollars returned back to the country, right? What is the evidence? Is there a public right to know what and how and where did the money go, right? None of that. There's no transparency whatsoever, even within the system where they claim that we have gotten back money to the public funds from these corrupt officials or individuals, right? And so, okay, great. Yes, there's a lot of corruption in Saudi Arabia. Fantastic. Okay, can you prove it? Can you show us the evidence? Can you tell us what they actually did? Was they, I believe I saw the statistics that it was 60% of the income of the government last year, something like that. I was like, that is an amazing amount of money that went back into the coffers of the state. But again, the judiciary had very little to do with it. There were no court cases, there was nothing public, there were no details revealed about what did they actually steal and from whom. And so no, I mean, I wish that, the judicial system was more transparent than this, but it obviously isn't. And they don't even understand the basics of what is evidence. I mean, I will talk about, I saw the court documents related to Loujain's case. Basically, Loujain's case and every case I've seen, and I've seen so many of them, right, where they're politically motivated, most cases are based on the confession of the person arrested, right? And so if the confession is brought by torture, and so how do you even trust that this person has actually confessed to a crime that is true, that has evidence? There is no such thing. And so everything within Loujain's indictment specifically, for example, are things that she already made public in her tweets, or, for example, applying for a job at the UN. That is considered a crime in Saudi Arabia, although there is no such thing. There is actually no crime in Saudi Arabia that says if you applied for a job, you can be arrested, right? And so the ridiculousness of the judicial system itself and how it justifies political oppression is really quite astounding. I mean, if it wasn't so frightening and that people were dying in prison and being tortured and sexually harassed, this is stuff of comedy. You cannot read them without laughing out loud. The ridiculousness of them is just something. I just read... I don't know if you heard of Isra al-Ghamgham. Isra is one, I think she's the only woman in Saudi Arabia that they asked for a death penalty for, and then they withdrew the death penalty. Today, she got her conviction for 8 years in prison. And I was reading her indictment, and it was just, it's the same thing. The indictment is based on her alleged confessions, right? Her and her husband's. And it is basically the charges are that she organized protests, she filmed protests, right? And so basically, like, I could have been arrested for that. I could have been put in prison for that. I could have, as a journalist, been put to jail in Saudi Arabia for filming protests. This is the ridiculousness. They don't even understand. There is no self-awareness in this government where they don't even realize how ridiculous the charges are that they're the placing against people. And so it's I really encourage you to read them. Loujain's indictment specifically is available on her website. So if you have the energy and the mental headspace to be extremely angry and laugh at the same time, please go read it.
Thank you so much for your question. It was very interesting to hear your answer. I think that kind of led us into a very interesting question we actually thought about asking before about activism and risk. And Safa, we know from reading up on you that you are very accustomed to making this kind of judgment between what is, like, what risks are you prepared to, like, endure for your work. We specifically, like, got very... You tell this story about a Yemeni woman who de-escalated a run-in with two teenage kids from ISIS that we think was very... both kind of funny, but also very, like, it kind of gives a very human face to that issue. So when you make that kind of decision about, like, what is worth it, both for yourself in risking it and for the people you interview, how do you do that? When do you decide? And what you decide upon when you decide that, like, this risk is worth it?
That's a difficult question. So the risk is something I think there's a basic risk that you have to take with this work, right? And that you have to factor in that, for example, if you're going to a front line, there's a clear risk that you have to calculate, right? And you have to be smart about how you calculate that. I think the difficulty is when you're working, for example, if I juxtapose my experience in Yemen and my experience in Saudi Arabia, I would say that was infinitely scarier for me to do that in Saudi. And I remember that feeling in Saudi because it's like you never knew when you're going to be arrested, right? Because there's no clear flat line. There's no one shooting at you on the other side. There's no clarity of who's your enemy, right? And so a lot of the danger comes from you not knowing when things are going to happen, right? And I remember filming one of the protests when I was in Qatif. And it was just a completely different feeling because the danger of doing this kind of work in your own country versus another country, right? There's an emotional distance that any journalist has when it's somewhere else, right? And so I think it's how you calculate risk. You're constantly recalculating risk. You're constantly trying to assess, is this still safe, right? And sometimes you have to double down. It's like, okay, that's it. I'm here. There's no way of me getting out of this. I've already decided to do this. But I found like a lot of people ask, do I regret doing that film? Because that film stopped me from being able to go home. And I always say no, I do not regret doing that. I just regret it being the last film. I wish I was able to do more before I managed to get myself banned. But it's unfortunately, it is part of the reality of there's no space for journalists to work independently from the narratives of the state. And this is why it's so difficult to get anything out of Saudi Arabia. It was so hard for me to even get commissioned for that film. And I know you'll get to media and criticism later, but it took me a year to get it commissioned because every commissioner in the West that I pitched this film to was like, but what, you don't want to do women driving? Why do you want to do protests? I was like, because it's the longest protest in the history of Saudi Arabia. It is phenomenal. It's been going on for years and nobody's covering it. Everybody's covering all the other Arab Spring, so-called Arab Spring in the Arab world, yet you don't think Saudi Arabia deserves to be covered in the same way. And so there's a lot of prejudice, racism, cliches, stereotypes, all of these things when it comes to what resistance in Saudi Arabia needs to look like, right? And unfortunately, I think with the woman, they wanted to pigeonhole me, and she's the woman. She should do the story about women driving because that's the only issue that was going on in Saudi Arabia at the time. Everybody was only interested in the ban on driving. And unfortunately, it became a cliche itself, right? A lot of criticism inside Saudi Arabia is like, we have so many fucking issues in Saudi Arabia. Why are you focusing just on the driving? But I think the symbolism of the ban of the driving was what women were going for, right? But that narrative was so difficult to get through because in the West, it fit their stereotype. Oh, the backward, conservative, Muslim country, you know, with a closed society and all of that, it fit all of the perfect stereotypes of this Orientalist outlook, right? And so this is what they wanted to continue to perpetuate. They didn't want a more complicated outlook on what is Saudi Arabia. What does Saudi Arabia look like? What is the history of resistance in Saudi Arabia? And so it became part of the problem of the narrative of how we in Saudi Arabia can get back that narrative and that we speak for ourselves and we talk about what is actually going on in Saudi Arabia and what our priorities are and not what other people want to project to us as their priorities.
Yeah, I think you're getting to a very interesting thing that we were asking, we're going to ask you about, that what kind of stories do you feel important to tell? If you want to elaborate a bit about that.
Yeah. I mean, there's so many. This is what I'm trying to say of the problem with how Saudi Arabia is being covered right now. We are stuck between two things. We have the Western white gaze on how they want to see Saudi Arabia in the region, right? And then we have extremely censored Arab media that is either owned by Saudi Arabia or Qatar or UAE, right? And so they all have conflicting interests and agendas, right? And there is nothing in the middle. There's nothing in the middle that can portray real life in the region without being without being one of those polarities, right? And they are polarities of narrative. And so I would love to see a lot more nuance in how Saudi Arabia is covered, right? I would love to see a lot more things done on what is happening actually in the southern border of Saudi Arabia with Yemen. I would love to see how these villages are now surviving. I would love to see a follow-up on the woman driving in Saudi Arabia. I would love to see an in-depth investigation about poverty and unemployment in Saudi Arabia. I would love to see all of these. I would love to see a three-dimensional coverage of Saudi Arabia that is consistent, that is in-depth, that is complex, as any people are, right? Like, you wouldn't just do one documentary on America and say, okay, that's it. We've done a film on America now. We'll come back to it in 5 years. But people do say that about Saudi Arabia. It's like, oh, we already done that. Right, we don't need another one. It's just like, and so it's not about the topic about Saudi Arabia that I would love to do. I would love an accumulative effect and diversity to the storytelling that we deserve as humans, right? I don't think we're being dealt as human. We're either a Saudi Arabia that is ruled by MBS, right? And so there's an obsession with Mohammed bin Salman as the crown prince, just like there was an obsession with Trump, that the American media paid the price for this obsession with Trump, with where we got right now with what happened in on January 6th, right? What is happening in Saudi Arabia right now, the reduction of what's going on right now to these two polarities. MBS and everything that has to do with MBS is super sexy and attractive to the West, and everybody wants to cover from that aspect, as if Saudi Arabia cannot be seen without the prism of MBS, right? Or the what is now an acceptable thing to talk about, which is the war in Yemen, or the women rights activists, right? And women's rights activists specifically, not as much as the men, although the number, because of the number, I understand that. But there's a problem in just talking about these things without talking about the layers of what's going on in Saudi Arabia, right? And so this is my frustration with one, our problem in the Arab world, that there isn't enough space for us to tell our stories ourselves in Arabic and in depth, right? And there is no space really in the West or interest in doing these complicated stories. They're just simply isn't, right? They only want to justify their own stereotypes in what's going on in Saudi Arabia, which is extremely complicated, because then I have to fight the white gaze, and I'll have to also fight the Saudi government. So between the patriarchy and the white supremacy, and you're in the middle trying to say your own thing. And it's a tough balance, honestly. So I end up not doing much for very long until I find that niche of a story that I'm comfortable morally in doing.
Thank you. That was extremely interesting. And yeah, I think, yeah, at least I got something from that. So now I'm going to give the word to Nadine, if you want to ask your question, and then I'm going to leave it to Shaili to ask some questions about media.
Thank you so much. Just wanted to ask, like you mentioned earlier, that there's this lack of structural reform in Saudi Arabia. Could you maybe elaborate on what kind of structural reform you think is needed? And in the same vein, do you think that women's rights will ever truly be achieved under the Saudi regime?
Well, I'll take the last one first. I think patriarchy and misogyny are global issues, right? And so if we're talking about women's rights in general, we're still talking about equal pay in the United States, for example, right? We're still excited that the first female vice president in history. And so we are not out of the context of how misogynistic and patriarchal the world is, right? And so just to put in that, I think it's an important thing to remember, right? Saudi Arabia has made itself into an exception because of the woman driving, for example, because they thought they're outside history for some reason. And so I think what's happening, and which is forcing the Saudi government to open up in the way they are, is the economy. Right. And so they are realizing that they must open up and be less strict as a society and as a government, because otherwise economically will absolutely fail. Right. The percentage of unemployment in youth in Saudi Arabia is almost 40. That is a horrendous amount. This is not something that can be sustainable for a state, right? And I think this is something that they are very, very afraid of, right? This is how revolutions start. Yeah, when youth cannot even make their own living, where they cannot even, I mean, the housing crisis in Saudi Arabia is horrendous. Everything, like the cost of living, life itself, all of these things are accumulating and being made worse, right? And so I think it was 20 years ago, I was asked to speak at Harvard about why Saudi Arabia is banning women for driving, right? And I'm like, until they cannot afford to anymore, they will still ban women from driving, because I saw as an economic privilege of a state, of a country, that they could afford not to have half of the population not be an actual active members of society, right? And until that happened, until they really got hurt, that is truly what happened, right? The structural reforms, that to me is the billion-dollar question of how you structurally reform a patriarchy to truly respect human and women's rights. I don't have an answer to that, actually. I have a preference of what's the nature of the state that I would like to live in Saudi Arabia, right? But I think As you know, there is now a new political group that was announced on the National Day of Saudi Arabia last year called NAS. And they are as well struggling with what does that look like? How do you even get there, right? And so all of these are, I think, the growing pains of a country that has banned all political parties, right? Has banned even unions. We're not even allowed to have a union in Saudi Arabia. And so as a people, we have not had the experience of collective work, right? Collective bargaining, understanding of how we work together. The state has made it so nearly impossible for you to trust anyone else, right? We don't know how to work with each other, even the ones abroad, right? It's a really steep learning curve of disagreeing with someone without completely cutting them out, right? Because we don't know how to do that as a society. We're absolutely black and white, right? Which is, I would like to compare it to the Yemenis. The Yemenis are the opposite of us, right? They're in the middle of a civil war, yet you can find a living room with all the different members from different political parties chewing cloth together, right? They have that in their culture, that you can disagree politically with each other, yet you still have space for each other. In Saudi Arabia, there isn't that openness, right? It's extremely black and white in how they deal with their differences, right? Forget the political, even social. Those are really parts, unfortunately, of the things that we as Saudis abroad or in exile right now that are struggling with, of how to come to a consensus of what are we asking for, right? How do we get there? And so I'm not trying to dodge your question. I'm genuinely saying this is something we're all thinking deeply about. What does that mean for us, right? Without excluding the other. And because there are extremes in us as well outside. And so how do we talk to each other? How do we completely disagree and still be on the same table? How do we find a way forward that respects everybody's opinions as we go? It's really challenging.
Yes, that was such a good question, a really good answer. You have so many good answers to all these very broad and difficult
questions. I'm trying to fill out the space of me and Lina.
You're doing an amazing job, I have to say. And I was thinking in terms of, you did mention media and the criticisms. So I thought we could talk a bit about that. So in general, like what role does the media play in terms of reporting on all of these human rights violations, would you say? And do you feel like they fulfill its responsibility kind of?
I think the media role is vital, vital, right? And the difference in when media's role become successful, and for example, the release of Loujain, or putting the pressure on someone like Loujain to be released, or getting justice for Jamal Khashoggi's murder, for example, is one, the consistency of coverage, a cumulative effect of coverage, right? Where there is a concentration of effort to say, this is a story that we're going to consistently talk about, right? And this is the difference. And so I think as a journalist, there are journalists in this group right now, you'll see there is an emphasis now on the impact. What's the impact of your story, right? When in actuality, it's a lie, because rarely does one story truly make an impact. It's the accumulative effect of a lot of different journalists working on the story, getting different angles of it, and having different access that gives it that weight. Right? When the New York Times and the Washington Post and Le Monde and the Guardian and everybody across the board is reporting that story and reporting it from different angles, this is where you feel like, oh, okay, this is a big story right now, right? It's not the one story that a newspaper or TV station that does that really makes. Very rarely. I mean, those are your unicorns, right? Like, you're very lucky if you get one of those. But really, as a journalist, I think we are now, there's too much emphasis on the individual, on the star journalists, on how many followers you have on Twitter, right? or Instagram. And this is really toxic to me. I refuse this this model, especially as a freelancer. It gets a bit difficult. I refuse this model because it gives the illusion that you're out there alone. So even like we're talking about blowback of a story, right? Where it becomes the individual themselves that are now responsible. It's not like there is an institution behind me that also holds responsibility. Attack is on me, and especially on women, right? And so they become easier targets. They are more easily physically attacked. Your looks. Oh, she looks ugly. She's fat. She looks like whatever, right? Like there's constant body shaming involved in it, and as well. And so a lot of us actually, it's exhausting. And so there needs to be a lot more awareness, I think, from commissioning editors when it comes to doing these stories. It's like, understand the context of this and be consistent about covering it. My pet peeve with Yemen is like, oh my God, it's the forgotten war. Fuck you, you're the one who forgot. You're the editor who forgot to commission the story. You're not the one who forgot about it. The world didn't forget about it. Yemenis didn't forget about it. You did. You forgot to commission that story consistently. Just because you sent someone a year ago, if we're lucky, a year ago to Yemen, doesn't mean that you've done your duty of care on the story. It does not. It is the worst humanitarian crisis in the world. You have a conglomerate of a coalition of human rights violators, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Egypt, God knows what they're doing, the Americans, the French selling weapons, the Italians were selling weapons, everybody was selling weapons. It is an amazingly complex story. Yet, all they're doing is like, oh, look at those starving babies. Everybody is covering it by going to a hospital and taking a picture of a baby that is starving with a bloated belly, right? Because that is not a complicated story. Everybody knows that, oh, you can get people to click on the story because they don't have to understand the conflict. All they have to understand is that this baby is dying. Sorry, this makes me upset, but like there's really a role for the media of how they choose to make people understand the story, right? And that is a massive responsibility. And so now with Loujain, for example, we're very lucky because her family are so fucking courageous that they will speak constantly. Everything, something happened, they go out and they speak and they say this has happened, right? This is not the case for a lot of the other prisoners, right? And so it's made it easier for the media to keep up and pick up the story and continue with it, right? With Jamal Khashoggi's murder, it was also the same. It seems that every journalist in Washington, D.C. knew him, right? And so they had this vested interest in finding out what happened with Jamal. But that is not the case with most of the story. So I'm actually quite curious now how the media is going to continue to cover the women activists that are still in jail, right? And so it's really up to the media of what they bring to light and what they don't. It's an active choice. Sorry, I swear a lot. I hope I didn't upset anybody's
no, that's fine.
Feelings, but I don't care.
No, that is so fine. Go ahead. Absolutely. Yeah, and I think it's really, really interesting what you're saying about the whole consistency thing, that, you know, in this accumulative kind of thing with the media and their responsibility that the media has with all of this, definitely. And I thought that we could take another question now from the chat. And then I see that Hani, you've written another question, if you wanna bring that up to the floor.
Ahlan, hello. I will show and tell you, mashallah, I'm also as angry as you are towards Saudi Arabia. And there's also some stories I want to show you about, but one of the questions I want to give you about, what's your intake about the Abu Sin case happened in 2016? This also case that happened because this small kid was talking to an American lady and he was arrested for just talking online to an American lady.
But I don't know that story.
That happened in 2016. It actually happened.
Okay. I was busy with the war in Yemen. I didn't hear that one. Sorry.
Oh,
sorry. So, but what's the question?
But I know about that question. Like they were forbidding young kids to talk to foreigners abroad. They're arresting them and they tortured kids for talking to foreigners abroad. Is this also part of the Saudi law?
That's a good question. I doubt it's part of the law, but it doesn't have to be, which is my point of there's no clarity to what is actually a law or not, because it's very loose, right? So you can interpret it in any way you want, terrorism laws, right? And so, for example, you could be in law, right? They tried to also put feminism as a part of the anti-terrorism law, but they walked that back, although they made the graphics and everything.
Right.
It was quite something. Walk that back as well. And so, to answer your question, it doesn't have to be the law, right? It's some people find something objectionable, they arrest you. And also now, what is frightening as well is that sometimes if there's too much interaction on social media, if something goes viral, then they will also react to it. For example, when Malaka Shehri went out and she posted a picture of herself, I think in 2000, they arrested her, right? Not because they did it right away when it happened. So there's a lot of a public issue or not, right? And so it's very moody. I can't. But also they want to make an example of someone, so they arrest them. It doesn't have to happen.
La ilaha illallah.
Nasser, do you want to say something about it?
I couldn't hear you. We lost you, I think.
Yeah, I think your internet was breaking up a little bit.
Yes, we couldn't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm saying, I saw Nasser nodding his head when Hani was saying the case. So I'm saying, if you have anything to add to it, then please feel free, because I don't know the case.
Well, he was talking about Abu Sin. He was a child, like 12 or 13 or something. But he was talking in a program with the American or European girl, and they were making fuss about it and Twitter, and became a big deal. And they kidnapped the child for a couple of days, and he was out, I think, after a few months or a few weeks. But yeah, when you make fuss about something in the media and the government doesn't like it, they will kidnap you for a couple of days and return you when things calm down.
Yeah, I mean, it is something that they do just to take an example, to make you an example, right? It's like, we don't want to encourage this kind of behavior. It doesn't matter if there's a law for it or not. They're going to arrest you for it. So then, just to send the right signals to everybody else, if they even dare to think of doing the same thing, right? And so they use it as a training for the people to understand what is and what isn't the red line at the moment, right? And part of the scary thing of what's happening right now in Saudi is that the red lines are changing a lot and really fast, right? So you don't actually know, have I crossed the line or not? Where is the line? You don't even know where the line is anymore, right? And that is a really big problem right now, because we were talking about how do you assess risk, right? You assess risk when you know enough information about your environment and you say, okay, this is where I'm willing to go with it, right? What's happening in Saudi right now is that you don't know where your risk is anymore. So you're not consciously making decisions that, okay, I know the risk of this. You don't. They could ignore you completely. Nothing happens.
Like, but also,
or they could arrest you. I mean, it's an either or situation, you know?
But another point, since I'm from Lebanon, they made a law in Lebanon that you cannot allow to insult Saudi Arabia on social media. I was almost arrested for standing against Saudi Arabia back in Lebanon. Because I was criticizing the Saudi Arabian government, I was criticizing MBS against Yemen, and they almost arrested me, the Lebanese government, for that.
Yeah. Well, Nabil Rajab, who's a famous human rights activist in Bahrain, was arrested in Bahrain for tweeting against the war in Yemen. And so, yes, the Saudi reach is
it's
quite deep, yeah.
In terms of this, I would like to know, like, how is it with active, because I know social media plays a big part in activism in general. So how, like, does activism look on social media in Saudi Arabia or in regards to Saudi Arabia? Do you know anything about that?
It plays a massive role in Saudi Arabia right now. Unfortunately, because there is no public space, even before COVID, the pandemic, the public spaces in Saudi Arabia weren't available for people to discuss things freely, to be anonymous and discuss things freely, right? And especially for women, because women had even less public space than men did, right? And so social media, and especially Twitter, became this forum where people can talk and express their opinions and say whatever they want, or, and especially for the feminist movement, I think it was really something that enabled women to galvanize, right? And so I say this all the time. The best thing about Twitter for me is Saudi feminist tweets. They are the best thing about it because they're supportive, they reach out, they all support each other. If one of them disappears for a bit, they ask about her. Like, they've created this really interesting solidarity on this really toxic platform generally for in Saudi Arabia, right? And so unfortunately, what the government did is that when they realized that this is such a powerful tool, the first thing they did is they created their own digital army. They created their own trolls, and we call them flies in Saudi Arabia, the Bab. And so they started intimidating people who were having these conversations. They started altering even what hashtags were trending in the country, right? And so all of these things are an awareness that, I mean, in the majority of the country are youth, right? And so youth across the board are using social media more than anything to communicate, even in the same house, you know, you're texting, you're not going out and talking to someone, right? And so this is something that the government has spent a lot of money on to control those narratives, to spy on everyone. And I'm sure everybody here knows about the two spies that they actually put in Twitter. There were two staff in Twitter that were spying on behalf of the Saudi government, and the case is still ongoing in California. And so the government has made it so clear that they're ubiquitous in everybody's digital life, right? They have access to your phone. They have access to everything about you digitally inside Saudi Arabia. And that is becoming something extremely difficult to navigate when you're trying to communicate safely, right? And it's not even just about politics. For women, it is a massive issue to keep yourself safe and anonymous in the digital age. And that's becoming nearly impossible right now. And so I don't know how this is going to be fixed, honestly. It's a really scary space right now.
Yeah, no, definitely. It is very scary space, and it's scary how they like manage to keep track even on digital platforms. Definitely.
Yeah. I mean, one of our concerns is that the Trump administration was actually sharing intel with the Saudis based on what their access is to everybody's digital security, right? And so it has become, at least for us, even in the outside, I mean, I can't tell you how many of us have been hacked. In the last year, there have been, I don't know, tens of attacks on people, right? And so they are still actively trying to hack into people's accounts. So you have to constantly be a step ahead of them. And only if you're lucky do you realize that you've been hacked.
Yeah, that is very, very problematic in so many ways. Do you think, like, with social media and everything, with Loujain's case, do you think that it played a big role also in her conditional release?
Hmm. Okay. Every time somebody gets arrested or gets released, we ask ourselves what worked, right? What or what didn't work? And it's always a mystery. What are the pressure points of the government? Of what is the threshold when they want to appease or when they don't, right? And that is a really difficult equation to answer, honestly, right? The clearest answer for us at the moment is that they want to please the Biden administration and get some pressure off of them, right? But that's an easy answer, what will happen after this? How do we continue to keep pressure on the Saudi government, right? And what works and what doesn't? For example, we were all shocked when Waleed Al-Fatahi, who is a binational, a dual national Saudi and American, was convicted when we thought that he was for sure going to be released, right? Because even the Trump administration themselves were intervening on behalf of Waleed to be released. And it didn't work. And we're talking about the Trump administration, right? And so it, I want to be optimistic and say that the Saudis are going to be on their best behavior because the Biden administration is now in and they're saying that we're going to reassess our entire relationship with themselves. I'm very critical of how deep that reassessment is going to be, okay? But for example, if they do release the CIA assessment of who killed Jamal Khashoggi, if they name Mohammed bin Salman as the person who ordered the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, and they actually take it to court and it goes through, and the ramifications both legally and politically on Mohammed bin Salman and in the country, then we'll see how serious the American government is about the reassessment of the relationship with the Saudis, right? Because they said we are no longer going to support hostilities in Yemen. Okay. But then Blinken does a call with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Saudi Arabia and says, we believe that Saudi Arabia should have our support in continued self-defense, right? So is this a way out for the Americans to continue selling weapons to Saudi Arabia in the name of self-defense? Okay, so where are we then? They're not gonna sell them weapons that are for sure not gonna be used in Yemen. The Americans deliberately and specifically said that they're not going to be stopping their war on Yemen when it comes to counterterrorism, right? As in fighting Al-Qaeda and ISIS in Yemen. How are they fighting this war right now on the ground? They're fighting it via intelligence from the Emiratis and the Saudis. Okay, so how are you going to untangle this relationship between the American intelligence, the Saudi and the Emirati when it comes to on the ground war? And so, I mean, they've left everything extremely vague, and I think to leave deliberate wiggle room for them, right, where they can continue business as usual without the criticism of continuing business as usual, for them to look better. Yeah, and I worry that they're going to continue exactly the same policies as Trump, but they won't have as much pressure on them as it was on the Trump administration. So we shall see. I will wait for that CIA report.
Yes, we will see, definitely. So I thought maybe, because you start talking a bit about the international society, and so I thought, Alicia, you wanna take over in regards to that?
Sure, we can come in on that now. Yeah, I think you already answered very well the question we have planned on of the new United US pressure when now Biden has become president. But we have also have the always present issue of the pandemic. Has that has an impact on human rights in Saudi Arabia?
It did. I mean, there, as I mentioned before, a lot of people's cases were deferred because of the pandemic, but also we stopped hearing from the prisoners themselves for months. They wouldn't even get a phone call. And so part of the excuse that they were giving is, oh, it's because of the pandemic, but what does the pandemic have to do with a phone call? Right, and so they had a complete blackout on many of the prisoners, and we were extremely worried at the time of what's going to happen. But that in April of last year, Dr. Abdullah Al-Hamid died in prison, and we believe he died of medical neglect. And so it is for sure, I think, used by the state as an excuse to silence people more. Right. And so it was harder. It was even harder than it was before to get accurate information about what is the position and the status of the political prisoners. Many political prisoners started hunger strikes during that time because they weren't getting their basic rights in prison. And Loujain had two hunger strikes because of that. Right. So it was definitely used as an excuse, as far as I'm concerned, to silence and just disappear people. I mean, if we talk about disappearances, Abdurrahman al-Sadhan has been disappeared for years now, and his family only got one phone call the entire time he was disappeared, and they haven't even admitted that they had him. And so it is clear that the government, on some cases, doesn't care at all. Like they're not answering to anything. And his sister Arij, who is actually an American citizen, who's in the States trying very hard to lobby for his release, or at least an acknowledgement of where he is, because he's still technically disappeared, and nothing. And so goes to your question of, I don't know what works. Some things work, some things don't.
Yeah, that's very true. It's a very complex issue.
Yeah.
But we're very happy, as we have said many times, to hear of Loujain's conditional release. But have there been other releases during this time, or is this just like a one-off occasion? Do you think this could be like a start of a trend, even though it's hard?
They did release several people last week, right? So they had several releases. The thing is now, which is an interesting phenomenon, where families are not even wanting to announce that their sons or daughters have been released, right? As part of the conditions of like, don't talk, don't say anything, right? Don't increase the profile. And you'll see that they're shutting down their social media profiles, for example, right? And so this is part of the scary thing of the government. They're erasing you as you are alive. They're silencing you from your activism as a condition of release. And that's the case for a lot of the women, for example, who were conditionally released, that they barely say anything. They send a picture when they're released, and that was that. Right, it happened with Aziz al-Yusuf when she was released. They posted a picture with her and her son Salah. Then her son Salah got arrested about a week or 2 weeks after that. And so it's just because they released a batch of people now doesn't mean that there's going to not be another wave of arrests that comes afterwards with new excuses of why they arrested them. Right, and then we start all over again with this entire cycle of campaigning for them and releasing them and putting pressure on them and lobbying in Congress. And so it's this vicious cycle. And this is what I mean. There needs to be a structural change. So then this vicious cycle stops, where it's like, what is the law here? Why are you disappearing people? Did they break the law? Where is the law that they broke? Let's be clear about what that is. At least there's clarity about what we are working against. What they want is for us to have this busy work, right? They're constantly keeping us busy with these things, that we're not building something real, something substantial, right? So I don't know how to stop that. Going back to Nadine's question, I have no answers.
Yeah, I can understand that, but it gives a very dark picture of the future of like human rights movement in Saudi Arabia.
Well, okay, so dark as in I do not believe that this government is genuine about reform and respecting human rights, right? But yeah, not dark in my belief in the people of Saudi Arabia and my fellow Saudis outside that have a genuine interest and ability to change things, right? And so I don't see that as dark. I actually see that as something really powerful and empowering to me, right? That we are not alone, but there are a lot more people right now that want genuine reform in Saudi Arabia and are willing to pay the price for it. And so from that perspective, I say no. This is not the darkest part of the history of Saudi Arabia. Actually, there is a lot more collective resistance against injustice in Saudi Arabia than ever before. Just to be unusually helpful.
Yeah, but it's always good to look to people and see their belief in human rights and their actions. And
I would say after Jamal Khashoggi's murder, a lot of us were looking around and saying, okay, this government really, there are no limits to the efforts that will go to silence someone, right? And I think they wanted that as a message to everyone, right? that be quiet or this will happen to you. The opposite happened, where a lot more of us started getting together, talking to each other, even though the ones we fundamentally disagree on, even the outlooks of life, have started talking to each other right now. It was like, this is, we need to think of something more substantial to do now, right? We need to up our game now because of the government and what they've done to Jamaat. And so I think that was a pivotal moment for a lot of people, of like, they've decided to speak up, they decided to be more public than before. And so for all of us, I think that was a catalyst, really.
Yeah, and I think, Clara, I see your question. I think it fits really well here. So if you want to ask it.
Yeah, you kind of touched upon my question, but I'm just wondering kind of what the climate or the attitudes among the public towards the activism, and maybe if that has changed in recent years. Or like the attitudes among the public, like in regards to
Saudi people.
Yeah, exactly.
Towards activism. I mean, I don't know, because there's no way of knowing what is public opinion in Saudi, because there is no independent journalism. There is no independent outlets, right? They're manipulating everything that is in the digital realm, right? And so what I can tell you is that a lot more people have gone quiet, right? A lot more people are opting to leave the country than ever before, if that is an indicator of how scary things are inside the country. The economic situation itself is, not thought of enough, of how hard it is now to maintain the life that we used to have, let's say in the 80s or 90s, right? That is no longer it. The economic hardships in Saudi Arabia now are extremely challenging. It is hard to have a small or medium-sized business in Saudi Arabia right now. And so all of those things are making it, I think, indicators of, even if you're not political, like now there's a hashtag for the unemployed, right? And it is an indicator of like people don't know how to not be political, not organize, not go out and protest. Okay, so what can we do? We can start a hashtag, you know? and that's the problem, right? Because there's no way of actually knowing what people are thinking. And then pro-Saudi regime defenders would be like, oh, Qatar started the hashtag. It's an Iranian conspiracy. It's I don't know what, right? So always pushing it, because it's in the digital realm, right? It's not a physical protest on the ground that you can say there is a protest here. And so, Clara, I don't know. I don't know what is the opinion of the public, because that is deliberately something that is kept a mystery in Saudi Arabia. Right? And that should tell you more than anything. That should be your answer, that we don't know.
Yeah, thank you so much for your question, Clara. I think I'm going to give the word to Christina, who has a question about Vian.
Hi. First, I just want to say thank you for your job as a journalist. I specialize in human rights law, and it's very important when journalists, you know, find evidence so we can have a case. So that's really good for you. But I want to know, do you know how Loujain is doing right now? Did you speak to her sister? Did you speak to her sister? Did you say how she's doing?
No, I'll leave that to Lina to okay. Say. All I can say is that she did share a picture of Loujain when she spoke to her. And so I prefer to leave those questions to the AlHathloul family. Yeah,
because I have followed this case, so I've just been so worried about it.
Yeah, we've all been. It's so amazing to see her. Yeah.
Okay. Good.
We all share that feeling, but I'll leave it to follow Lina and Alia and Waleed, and I'm sure they're going to share a lot more soon on Twitter and updating you guys about it.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Yeah, and I can say that for anyone who follows the women's rights group in Lund or Malmö, we'll keep on the case and update you with any new information that comes out so you don't miss anything. Yeah, so we're nearing the end now. So if anyone has any last question, make sure to send it in. And we'd just like to ask you that you have given a very like good picture of the activism right now that's happening around Saudi Arabia, even though it is limited in what it might be able to do with the government constraints. But is there anything we, either as amnesty groups or just activists, can do to make sure that either media attention is kept on this case, or anything concrete we can do to like support anything human rights movement in Saudi?
One concrete thing that you can do on Friday, Arija Sadhan, Abdurrahman Sadhan's sister, who I said was disappeared, she's trying to gain attention to his case again on Friday. And so I would love everybody here to follow her, support her, amplify her voice, amplify Sadhan's story. And it's just an example of, we need to diversify the number of stories that we concentrate on when it comes to Saudi, right? We need to diversify these individuals, so then you can feel like you know Abdurrahman, just like now you feel like you know Loujain and you're worried about her as an individual, right? And I think there is power and strength in the families when they feel like there's a lot of support around them when they speak up, right? Because there's so much fear in speaking up right now. And there are so many repercussions on the families inside Saudi Arabia when they do speak up, right? And so if we give them the environment of feeling like, if you speak up, there is an environment that is going to amplify you, that is going to speak up for you. So it's not just them being at the forefront, constantly trying to remind people, right? And so Abdurrahman Sadhan, his family has not heard a word from him in 2 years. I think now it's the anniversary of 3. They got one phone call of 1 minute. So just to know that he's alive, nothing after that. And so all of these stories are heartbreaking and frightening. And it's not just about Loujain, but even with Loujain, we have to keep up the pressure so then they lift the travel ban on her. So she's allowed to be free to leave if she wants to, or choose to stay in the country. It is her right, it's her freedom to do so, right? And so with all of these things, please read more and think more holistically on how you understand Saudi Arabia, right? And so it's not just this individual as a symbol, right? That they are a story among so many. Visit alqist.org. It has an extensive database of all the political prisoners, and you can they're both available in Arabic and in English. And so you can read about all the different political prisoners in Saudi Arabia and that whole rainbow of array of political opinions that you can clearly see in the kind of people that are being arrested, right? And so that when you speak to people about Saudi Arabia and why Saudi Arabia doesn't respect human rights or women's rights, you have a more holistic view and understanding of the country.
Thank you. I did not know that web page, so I'm definitely going to check this out.
Alqist is ALQST.
Yeah, for anyone who missed it, Nasser sent the link in the chat, so make sure to copy it and check it out when we're done.
That database is amazing. It really is. And if you have any questions, send it to them. They already know Amnesty really well, but if you have your own human rights organizations and you would like more accurate information about Saudi Arabia, AlQist is the place you should go to.
Thank you. Shaleen.
And Nasser is a member of the board, actually. He's one of the on the advisory board.
Yeah, great to have you here to make sure that we all know about this website then. Shaleen, do you want to add something? Because I see that we're almost running out of time right now.
The only thing I would like to add, like right now, is like I think Safa, you've done an amazing job these 1.5 hours, and I know that you were supposed to be talking together with Lina. So yeah, thank you so much for having all these amazing answers and doing this solo.
And thank you for tolerating me for 1.5 hours. That's a lot of talking.
No, the pleasure is ours. Absolutely. Yeah, I think you're so impressive, and I really think that everything you're saying is so good, and it's so important, and I think we will all remember everything. And yeah, again, I think you're really, really impressive.
Thank you. And thank you for everyone here who stuck around to listen to this and showed interest in Saudi Arabia. It really means a lot to us.
Yes. So does anyone have any last questions? Because if not, then I think this might be the end of this seminar.
Yeah, I'd just like to remind everyone that we have live streaming YouTube, and we will make sure that the video stays there, and we will share the link in the event we created on Facebook. So if you want to, feel free to keep sharing it so more people gets to hear everything that has been discussed tonight, the very interesting perspectives and questions that have been brought up. So keep sharing and keep reading up on this issue.
Definitely. I don't know if you can see the chat, Safa, but everyone's saying like thank you, and yeah, that they're gonna read more, and just so you know that everyone is very, very happy and thankful.
Thank you. Honestly, genuinely, thank you for showing the interest. And I hope this makes it easier for you to reach out and read more about this and understand the nuance and complexity of Saudi Arabia. We are more than MBS, really, we are. We're human beings who walk around the world, you know? And so I am on Twitter as well. If anybody wants book recommendations of what to read, there are a lot of really excellent books out there right now, and especially actually on the critique of feminism and the coverage of Saudi Arabia. So I'm happy to share books with you. I would love for this to be a start of a bigger and deeper conversation about Saudi and Yemen. If you go to my account, you'll see all the films I've done on Yemen. It's a pinned tweet, both in Arabic and in English. This is also phenomenally important to understand. Please feel free, watch them. They're all free on either BBC or Frontline PBS. If you have any questions about it, reach out to me. My DM is open. And if any trolls come my way, I'm gonna send them to you guys, okay? And Nasser. But genuinely, please reach out if you have any questions. I have so many books to suggest to you. There's a lot of really good content out there that makes you think critically, especially you in the West. Please think of the white gaze. Think of how that impacts your understanding of Saudi Arabia and the region. Think of what it means for patriarchy. Like, all of these things are interconnected. We're all connected in this way. And so you just need to understand it in a bit of a bigger context.
Yes, definitely. I hope everyone here will keep that in mind.
Yes, please. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So
thank you, everyone.
Goodbye. All right. So once again, thank you so much, Safa, and thank you all of you for coming. And yeah, let's keep the fight going.
Yes, please.
Thank you so
much. Hi. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Safa.
Thank you. Thank you.